Hello all. Warm greetings and welcome to the course Smart Grids and Electric Vehicles. Till now, we have introduced ourselves to the concept of electrical energy storage using batteries and discussed in detail about the constructional features, operation, chemical reactions, and performance characteristics for lead acid battery in submodule 2, nickel cadmium battery for submodule 3. Lithium batteries in submodule 4. We shall do the same and discuss the sodium sulfur battery in this submodule number 5. Sodium sulfur accumulators are high temperature batteries. They operate at temperatures above 300 degrees Celsius. The figure here shows a sodium sulfur accumulator with a cylindrical design. The negative electrode in the topmost negative sign, the negative electrode is located in the cell's interior. At operating temperatures, it is immersed in the liquid sodium, as you can see, the liquid sodium. Within the cylindrical ceramic and sodium cation, that is Na+, sodium ion Na+, conducting solid electrolyte made of doped sodium aluminium oxide. Doped sodium aluminium oxide. The chemical formula is NaAl12O17. It is very famously called as beta alumina. It is a doped sodium aluminium oxide. It is the electrolyte, solid state electrolyte, as you can see in the gray cylindrical cutout in the figure, the gray color cutout, solid state electrolyte. It's like a test tube with a hole at the bottom. This metal cylinder, the cylinder, separates the solid electrolyte from the sodium electrode. The sodium electrode, as you can see, is of golden color, and the sodium electrolyte, as you can see, is in the silver color. The metal cylinder is called a safety insert and is formed so that there is a controlled flow of liquid sodium from the interior. After losing its valence electron, sodium as a positive ion can diffuse through the crystal lattice vacancies of the solid electrolyte. Now, this is happening because metallic sodium is oxidized to Na+ during the discharging process. And we will see what happens in the discharging process in the coming slides. If the ceramic separator breaks, an internal short circuit results. The safety insert limits the flow of sodium so that the heat produced can escape and thermal runaway is prevented. In the outer part of the cell, the positive electrode, as you can see, is composed of graphite immersed in liquid sulfur contained in a cathode container, cathode bag, cathode container. All cells are placed in thermally insulated containers with integrated heating and cooling. A battery management system is required to regulate the temperature. So the battery management system, which is different from separate from this battery system, which is seen in the figure in this slide. Battery management system separates from the battery system and it regulates the temperature. The figure here is showing the chemical activity which is happening inside the beta alumina NaAl12O17. That is the beta alumina, also it is famously called as beta alumina, and is nothing but doped sodium aluminium oxide. In the beta alumina group, there are two clearly distinct crystal structures in a hexagonal array. Now the figure here is giving us the general idea of the relationship between the molecules, which you can see in circles, and their arrangement, how they are arranged. The spinel blocks, before we discuss the spinel blocks, let us first look into what the circles mean. The circles, hollow circles with only black color boundary, are O2 minus ions. The circles with blue color shade are Na plus ions. And the small circles which are attached closely to the bonded closely with the bigger circles are Al3 plus ions. Now what happens is, in the case of the sodium sulfur system, the separator divides the sodium on the negative electrode from the sulfur on the positive electrode, and that's what a separator does. We know that it separates both the electrodes. Now with this system, the separator, in case of sodium sulfur system, the separator must be exclusively permeable to cations for converting chemical into electrical energy, and vice versa. The sodium sulfur separator is made of ceramic. The primary component of the ceramic solid electrolyte is highly sodium ion conductive beta alumina, that is NaAl12O17. It resembles unglazed ceramic in appearance and is ion conducting at temperatures above around 300 degrees Celsius. It looks like a creamish texture. Interested students can look up into and can contact me, and I can send you the figures also, the real time figures. The composition of the beta alumina group of oxides is typified by alternating densely and loosely packed layers. There are few layers which are densely packed, and there are few layers which are loosely packed. The densely packed layers are called as spinel blocks, and the loosely packed layers are called as conductive surfaces, as you can see in the left side of the C-axis, conductive surface. These layers are composed of layers of oxygen ions paired with aluminum ions. The spinel blocks, on the other hand, are connected by the conductive surfaces. As shown in the figure, mobile sodium ions, the blue color circles, diffuse through the conductive layers which are perpendicular to the C-axis. Because of its sodium ion conducting characteristics, the separator is used as a membrane in the sodium sulfur battery. Here it resembles a cylindrical cup filled with liquid sodium. During the discharge, sodium is oxidized to Na+, so the sodium ion is Na+ ion. This can then diffuse through the ceramic, the separator, through the ceramic into the cathode holder containing the sulfur. Ceramic has a high compressive strength of around 2000 to 4000 megapascals and has a high resistance to corrosion and wear. As a result, it can tolerate the significant stresses in the sodium sulfur batteries. Moving further, here the figure, we will be looking into the charging and discharging process. Here the figure in the right side is giving us, representing the discharging process, where a lamp load is connected to the terminals of the sodium sulfur cell. The low electrochemical self discharge is typical of sodium sulfur cells. The battery self discharge only over very long storage periods without any charging or discharge. But to maintain a 20 kilowatt hour battery at operating temperatures, for example, around 100 watt of heating capacity is required. This phenomena is called as thermal self-discharge. If this is included in the electrochemical self-discharge, then the self-discharge is actually very high. So if thermal discharge is included in the electrochemical discharge, the electrochemical self-discharge, which was low, becomes very high. During discharge, metallic sodium is oxidized to Na+. The sodium ions, the Na+ ions, then diffuse through the ceramic electrolyte to the positive electrode, compensating for the charge of the polysulfide anions formed from the sulfur there. The electrons from the sodium electrode that reach the sulfur electrode through the external circuit reduce the elemental sulfur. As a result, Na2S5 is formed. Na2S5 is nothing but sodium pentasulfide. It's polysulfide. Na2SX is polysulfide, where X ranges from 2 to 6, 2 to 5. So Na2S5 becomes sodium pentasulfide. The chemical reaction which I have shown here in the slide is a highly simplified equation for the first discharging step. This is the first discharging step. Liquid pentasulfide, that is the Na2NS5, is disassociated into ions in the melt. In a charged state, the cell's open circuit voltage is calculated using the Nernst equation and comes around to be 2.08 volt. The cell's open circuit voltage in a charged state is about 2.08 volt. As long as adequate elementary sulfur remains, the voltage stays at this value, which is 2.08 volt. But the state changes and the voltage falls after around 65% of the discharge. Why this happens? This happens because of the low levels of sodium and sulfur remaining inside the cell after extensive discharge. So now what happens? From sodium Na2S, which is the sodium pentasulfide, Na2S4 is formed, which is the sodium tetrasulfide. At this stage of discharging process, the cell voltage falls from 2.08 volt to around 1.9 volt. Now further sulfur reduces. Now further reduction of sulfur by sodium causes the cell voltage to continue to fall. Because of the low sulfur content in the system, Na2S3 is formed. Na2S3 is now sodium trisulfide. Now this reduces the cell voltage from 1.9 volts to 1.78 volts. If discharging is continued even further, then the accumulator may get damaged by deep discharging. The formation of sodium disulfide Na2S2 has devastating consequences. Since the internal resistance rises dramatically at this stage, significant thermal loss and thermal stress may result for the cell. Manufacturers stop charging with the earlier formation of sodium trisulfide to extend accumulator's service life. This is achieved by interrupting the discharging process at a depth of discharge of around 70%. So after 70%, charging is required. Now we can determine the performance characteristics of a sodium sulfur battery in terms of efficiency, power density, and energy density. Several factors determine the efficiency of a sodium sulfur battery. In all batteries, losses are caused by internal resistance. In addition to ohmic losses due to internal resistance, in sodium sulfur accumulators, there are also thermal losses from maintaining the operating temperature. An accumulator's efficiency is determined by the operating current using the formula given here. Here U0 is the open circuit voltage, IE is the discharging current, IL is the charging current, and RI is the internal resistance. At an operating temperature of around 300 degrees Celsius, a sodium sulfur facility's efficiency comes about 85%. After power inversion and deduction of thermal heating in idle phases, the realistic efficiency is about 75%. The power density of sodium sulfur accumulators is about 200 watt per kilogram, and the energy density of sodium sulfur accumulators is about 218 watt hour per kilogram. To summarize, sodium sulfur accumulators are high temperature batteries with an operating temperature of around 320 degrees Celsius. This high operating temperature also determines the battery's characteristics. The cells are placed in thermally insulated containers and require heating and cooling. The electrode materials, sodium, sulfur, and sodium polysulfide, are in liquid form, and the separator is made of ceramic. Since sodium is highly reactive with water, it must be protected from contact with the environment in a metal container. During operation, current heat is adequate to maintain the optimal operating temperature. The heating system is required in idle phases. This also determines the efficiency. The battery itself has a low self-discharge rate, but over long idle periods, electric heating causes the battery to discharge at an unusually high rate. Efficiency, energy density, and power density are the performance characteristics which characterize the performance of the sodium sulfur battery. That's all for now, and in the next sub module we will be looking into the flow battery. Thank you so much for patient listening. One thing that I want to get here is, in case of any doubts, please quote the number of the file name of the video that you are asking about. You can ask me doubts through email, that would be much better, or through WhatsApp, and also you can call me anytime, but do quote the name of the video for which you are asking the doubt. Thank you so very much.